Recorded Books presents Inspector Chen and the Private Kitchen Murder by Qiu Xiaolong, narrated by David Shih. Day 1. Chen Cao, the ex-chief inspector of the Shanghai Police Bureau, now the director of the Shanghai Judicial System Reform Office, though currently on convalescent leave, woke with a start. It was just one of the weird dreams he had been having of late. He had found himself in a magnificent imperial court with gigantic dragon-embossed pillars. But the people groveling in front of the glittering throne were dressed in contemporary style, mostly in suits or mail jackets, rather than any ancient costumes. Unsure about the identity of the one perching majestically on the throne, he was debating with himself whether to kneel down like the others when, all of a sudden, a golden dragon tore itself violently from a vermilion-painted pillar, spitting fire, soaring over the court in the midst of the screaming and stampeding people. With the entire palace shaking, the dragon shot straight up through the roof. Breaking into a cold sweat, Chen tried to reassure himself that it was simply a nightmare, but an elusive feeling of unease lingered on in spite of himself. Yet, why should he care anymore? "You do not hope to turn again," Chen murmured a half-forgotten line, yawning with the knowledge that there was nothing urgent for him to do, and glancing up at the lazy sunlight streaming in through the checked curtains, which cast dubious shadows at the beginning of another day. For once, he was in no hurry to get up. On the contrary, he was supposed to stay relaxed in the dramatically changed circumstances. Nominally, he was the director of the new office, though it was a position of no real power after he had been removed from the police bureau and put on convalescent leave, a role specifically designed for a party cadre, regarded by the higher authorities as unfit for the position, yet whom it was unwise to fire right away. After a leave of uncertain length, however, it could be a different story, and he would sink into oblivion. With the term convalescent leave, an unmistakable signal that something was politically wrong with the ex-inspector, speculation spread online like uncontrollable wild weeds, in spite of the frantic governmental internet control. According to one blog post, it was not necessarily without a silver lining, however, since the term might also be read as an indication that Chief Inspector Chen was not yet totally finished, not without the possibility of staging a comeback in the changed circumstances. Turning in his bed, Chen thought he knew better. He reached for his cell phone on the nightstand. Sure enough, there was a short online article from Wenhui Daily about the Chinese writers' meeting with the French writers' delegation in the Shanghai Writers' Association. Among the Chinese names, Chen's appeared as well as his new title, with convalescent leave added in brackets. Underneath the news, several netizens had simply copied the phrase convalescent leave, along with a variety of emojis such as grimace or rage. One had actually chosen that of burial, showing a white-faced clown vigorously digging a grave, as in a Shakespearean play. Chen had ruffled feathers in one of his recent anti-corruption investigations, so his burial was seen as only a matter of time. The news about his appearance on an irrelevant occasion was, more likely than not, nothing but a reassuring gesture to the people who still wanted him to stay on as one of the few good, honest cops. He took a pack of cigarettes out of the drawer. Red Generation, another of the red products suddenly popular again in China, but he put it back without lighting one. The change in China's political landscape could not have appeared more ominous. One of the red princes was now sitting on the throne, and Chen's investigations had involved some other related red princes. Those investigations, while hailed as our great glorious party's determination to fight corruption at whatever level in the official media, could not but have been seen as acceptable to those in power. Politics aside, A short leave might not be too bad an idea for him. He needed a break. Having worked for years under the unrelenting stress of so many special cases, he was becoming easily tired, constantly highly strung, and restless. Rather than get up for a cup of coffee, he decided to stay in his bed. His hand reached out to the nightstand again. This time, he picked up a copy of a Judge Dee novel in English. It might be just as well for him to read throughout a day like this. With his head propped against a couple of pillows, he started reading in leisure, truly like one on leave. The novel had been given to him by a French writer named Bertrand at the meeting mentioned in the Wenhui Daily. In the conference room of the Shanghai Writers Association, Bertrand had said to him with a grin, "I finished reading it on the plane. An excellent book. I'm leaving it to you, Chief Inspector Chen. You may be a better reader for the Judge Dee novel, what with your knowledge of classical Tang Dynasty poetry and your expertise in police investigation in China." Chen thanked him profusely, took over the book, and said in earnest, "In my college years, one of my roommates discovered the series by Van Gulik and raved about it for weeks, yet without ever lending me a copy. Thanks to you, I'm going to read it. Judge Dee is so popular among Western readers. Quite a number of French writers have been writing and rewriting the Judge Dee stories. But this is an original one by Van Gulik. Poets and Murder. Let me know what you think of it. The opinions of an ace inspector in the city of Shanghai, a modernist poet, and a Judge Dee of the 21st century. Come on, I'm no judge nor..." He did not finish the sentence by saying the word inspector, which he was not anymore. But he was not yet used to not being an inspector either. And he saw no point elaborating on the complicated Chinese politics to a visiting French writer. In the morning light, Chen immediately noted something intriguing in the title of the book. The poets, plural. So more than one involved in a Tang murder case? The Tang Dynasty, the peak of classical Chinese poetry, had produced a number of outstanding poets, but surely not that many poet murderers. So how come a Chinese poetry-loving sinologist like Gulik would have chosen to write a murder investigation set among the Tang Dynasty poets? Leafing through the pages, he found several poets in the novel. Among them, a young, beautiful poetess who appeared to be a likely suspect in a bizarre murder case. If she alone had been involved, then why the plural poets? There seemed to be two or three cases going on in parallel, along with a mysterious fox spirit prowling in the background. How could all of them have been related to one another? Resisting the temptation to fast forward to the story's ending, he began to read from the beginning in earnest. The opening of the novel proved to be far more riveting than he had expected. It was surprisingly relevant to him for at least three reasons. It was about poets. It was about murders. And it was about a legendary Chinese investigator in the Tang Dynasty. Although, regarding the last aspect, the ex-chief inspector was not that sure. So why not spend the day in bed, reading all the way to the last page of the mystery? Before Chen could make too much headway with the book, a phone call came in. It was Detective Yu, his longtime partner in the bureau. With Chen assigned to the job in the new office, Yu was serving as acting head of the special case squad, in which the two had worked closely together for years.
"What's up, Yu?" "My father called me asking for your special cell phone number, but he would not tell me why."
It was like an alarm clock beginning to ring in the back of his mind. The retired cop, nicknamed Old Hunter, must have called for a reason, which he did not even want to reveal to his son, not merely a longtime partner in the police bureau, but a good friend of Chen's. The request for his special phone number sounded anything but reassuring.
"Well, Old Hunter must be up to one of his tricks.
sounding mysterious like a Sucho opera. Don't worry about that. How are things in the bureau, Yu?
Nothing special. Party Secretary Lee has asked about you several times, but it's just like a skunk greeting a rooster. We both know what he's really after. Why should I tell him anything about you? In fact, I haven't seen you for days.
I'm doing fine, you know.
So you're going to work in your new office soon?
Well, it's not up to the doctor to say whether I'm well enough for the job, but up to the party authorities, ultimately, to tell the doctor what he is supposed to tell me.
I'll be damned.
It's a leave I need anyway. At least I have some time to do some good reading and leisure. And I like it. Putting down the cell phone, Chen picked up the book again. He was beginning to feel a bit curious about Judge Dee for a different reason. As far as he knew, Dee in real life was not exactly a judge, nor an inspector. In his long official career, Dee might have worked as a judge on occasions, showing his extraordinary talents in ruling over difficult cases. But first and foremost, Dee was a successful politician. At one time, he was as high-ranked as the prime minister, playing a pivotal role in the complicated politics of the Tang Dynasty. The little Chen knew of Dee's official career came from his translation of the Tang Dynasty poetry during his research into this period of history, thus coming across the name of Dee Runjie in the background. Dee was highly thought of as a capable, honest official at a critical moment when the ambitious Empress Wu was seeking to turn the Tang Dynasty of the Li family into the Zhou Dynasty of the Wu family. A realistic Confucianist, Dee managed to serve under her, knowing better than to rise in feudal rebellion, but at the same time, trying his best to keep the line of the Li family unbroken. His perseverance led to the eventual restoration of the Tang Dynasty under the Lis, which happened shortly after Dee's death. With his limited historical knowledge, however, the ex-inspector knew he was not in a position to tell what Dee really was. For that matter, Chen was barely in a position to tell what he really was himself. He made an effort to pull himself out of self-pity and went on with the reading. Then he became fascinated not just by the legendary Tang figure, or the double or triple murders under Dee's investigation in the novel. There was something else pleasantly surprising. In those crime novels he had read, no main characters ever wrote poems. Not even Inspector Adam Dalgleish in the series penned by P.D. James, who portrays Dalgleish as a published poet without ever producing a single line throughout the series. Not so with this Judge Dee novel. Some of the poems in it struck Chen as authentic. It was not unimaginable for a renowned sinologist like Gulick, with all the background research he must have done for the book. It did not take long for Chen to come across a poem seemingly so familiar to him, though he failed to recollect any clue as to its authorship. Bitterly, I search for right words for this poem written under my lamp. I cannot sleep the long night, fearing the lonely coverlets. In the garden, in the soft rustling of the autumn leaves, the moon shines forlornly through the gauze window panes. Nor was he sure whether the lines quoted in the murder story comprised the entire poem. The question turned into an annoying puzzle for Chen, like an insistent fly buzzing around his ears. Shaking his head, he resumed his reading, but he was not meant to read on any longer that morning. His special cell phone rang. It was a new silver-colored one, with a chip purchased just a week earlier, and its number known only to three or four people he trusted. He picked it up in haste.
Long time no see, Chief Inspector Chen. How about having a cup of Dragon Well tea with me?
It was old Hunter, a retired cop turned part-time private investigator. It was probably a well-meant invitation from the old man who had learned about his trouble. That will be great, old Hunter. Where?
Let's go to People's Park. You remember the Birds Corner, don't you? Not far from it, there's another one called the Matching Corner. People have different names for it. Love Corner, mating corner, or marriage arranging corner, just to name a few I can think of. Whatever the names, the corner is listed as one of the must-see hotspots in the latest Shanghai tourist guidebook. Of course, I'm not interested in it for myself. But you have heard of my daughter's problem, haven't you? She is in her late 30s, a single mother, staying with us in the back room of the old Shikuman house. I want to take a look at the corner for her, and you may give me some suggestions there. Indeed, like the blue ocean having turned into the green mulberry field, the world has changed too much for an old, old-fashioned man like me.
True to his other nickname of Sucho Opera Singer, old Hunter could keep gushing on and on, rambling with continuous digressions and quoting proverbs and fables like a chef generously adding peppers. Chen listened with a touch of amusement. He had heard about this matching corner and about the problems of old Hunter's daughter, too. After her divorce, the old man had had no objection to her moving back in with her little boy. But what worried him was her wallowing in self-pity all day long in the dark, damp back room, instead of trying to turn over a new leaf for herself. But was old Hunter really that anxious to find someone in the park for her? Or for the ex-inspector, too, who remained a bachelor? The old man had talked to him about it a couple of times before. Holding the phone, Chen knew that his plan to lie in bed reading for the day was finished.
"We'll take a good walk in the park," old Hunter was going on, "and a cup of excellent tea afterwards. Guess what? I know the owner of a hot water house on Xinjiang Road, just across Nanjing Road. I'll bring in the genuine Dragon Well tea with me. The place also serves earthen oven cakes, salty and sweet, still hand-baked in the traditional way."
"I'll be there, old Hunter, in about half an hour."
"Great. It's close to the number 5 entrance of the park, you know."
Getting up, Chen put a bookmark reluctantly among the pages of Poets and Murder. Old Hunter was waiting for Chen in front of the park, standing by the side entrance close to the ex-Shanghai library, which had become something similar to an exhibition center for the ever-changing city. Still, Chen registered something recognizable about the ex-library, despite the dramatic changes in the area. On top of the umber-colored building, the black hands of the big clock kept moving in an undisturbed circle, with its beginning invariably coming to its ending, like a metaphor he had read in his college days. On that early May morning, old Hunter appeared to be overdressed for the occasion, wearing a black blazer of light material, khaki pants, black loafers, and holding a bright red umbrella in his right hand. It was a fine, cloudless day, but it seemed to be understandable, Chen reflected, for an old man in his brand new clothes to carry an umbrella.
"Well, you'll soon learn the true reason for such a bright-colored umbrella," old Hunter said with a mysterious smile, much like a Sucho opera singer about to reveal an astonishing secret in an exciting drama. Once they entered the park, they turned immediately right to a tree-shaded trail with green-painted benches scattered at intervals. The park, though smaller thanks to the nearby skyscrapers and subway stations continuously encroaching on its original size, appeared to be touching an equivocal chord in Chen's memory. Old Hunter raised his hand, pointing to a sizable crowd at a turn in the trail. Most of the people gathering there were old, gray or white-haired, sitting on stools or squatting, talking loudly to one another like in a morning food market. Chen noticed something else. Almost every one of them had an umbrella set out in front of them, unfolded on the ground. It made an amazing scene, eerily reminiscent of colorful mushrooms popping up in the sunlight after a spring drizzle. "You see,"
old Hunter said, moving closer to one of the umbrellas.
"The umbrellas function like stands, with information sheets scotch taped to them along with the colored pictures of young men or women. So detailed and vivid, their parents are therefore capable of matching them for all sorts of arrangements."
"And umbrellas can be handy for a rainy day too, I see," Chen said, nodding. A clever idea indeed. So the practice at the corner is just like a first step in the tradition of arranged marriage in ancient China, isn't it?
For those steps in ancient China, you should have listened to more Suzhou opera, through which you will learn all the details about the routine practice of professional matchmakers in the old days, such as the consultation of the fortune teller by examining the Chinese horoscope and the birth date for matching of the young people in question, Old Hunter said with great gusto. For the matching corner here, the arrangements are done by the parents and based on nothing but commercial or materialistic considerations and calculations in today's society.
Yes, totally materialistic. It's some progress for China in the 21st century.
Tremendous progress, you may say, Old Hunter said, shaking his head like an angry rattle drum. But you have to be realistic. In the present-day China, how can young people afford to be romantic without an apartment under their own name? A medium-sized one near the park is worth 7 or 8 million yuan. For an ordinary couple, that amount means more than they could possibly make by working hard all their lives without spending a single penny. The housing market is soaring out of control like crazy. But few are worried about the enormous bubble, thanks to the wonderful myth that the party authorities can always keep the bubble from bursting. So everything is all right with China. Take a close look, Old Hunter went on, leaning down to the information sheet posted on a yellow umbrella before an elderly woman. Attractive, tall, slender in her early 30s, and looking younger for her age. Never married. Good job in the state-run bank with excellent pay. More than 10,000 per month along with numerous benefits. The Shikuman unit she stays in with her parents is already under her name and under the government planning for demolishing. That meant she was eventually entitled to the unit, Chen supposed, which could be worth more in the event of its being pulled down in accordance with the city planning, as people living there would then be able to claim sizable compensation. Bemused, he moved over to a purple umbrella next to the yellow one. New apartment in Luwan District, along with a car spot in front of the building. All the mortgage paid, with another wing room for rent in Huangpu District.
That beats me, Old Hunter. How come a car spot is listed here?
Your luxurious apartment with a garage spot was state assigned to you before the beginning of China's housing reform. At the time, you did not pay a single penny for it, did you? And certainly not for the garage spot. That's why our party officials are supposed to be loyal to the party, in return for all the benefits. But it's just human nature for them to want more. Hence all the corruption cases under our one-party system, Old Hunter said, almost in one breath. Back to the garage spot for your apartment. It's a matter of course for a party official like you, whether you need it or not. You have a bureau car and a designated driver anyway. But for the ordinary people, a designated car spot can make all the difference. Otherwise, you may have to drive around for hours without finding a parking space. Guess how much for a car spot?
How much?
200,000 yuan. For the young people listed in the matching corner, they lose their social status without a car spot and a car.
That's absurd. The air quality is getting so horrible with more and more cars in the city.
Who cares? Incidentally, you may also see how much the second income at the agency means to me. For my poor daughter, she has not even a spot for her bike in the common courtyard of our Shikuman house. Nothing whatsoever worth showing off for her in the matching corner here.
I'm on leave, you know, but I may be able to speak to some people about a job. Chen cut himself short, choosing not to elaborate further. A number of his connections were beginning to avoid him, he recalled, since the news of his being on convalescent leave had come out.
Your situation is totally different, Chief. You don't have to worry about things on the info sheet on an umbrella. A three-bedroom apartment for yourself at the upper end of the city, not to mention your party cadre rank with numerous perks, and a real celebrity as a published poet to boot.
Come on, Old Hunter. You are looking for someone for your daughter, not for me. I am here today only as a consultant for you.
Have a piece, sir,
A woman in her mid or late 50s stood up and handed a sheet over the umbrella to Chen.
Take a good look at the picture, and you may call me any time at the number listed. Absolutely a beauty. My daughter, only 22. And so sweet, too.
All she needs is to have a good, successful man like you with a large apartment. And a bureau car, too, under your disposal, right? Chen took the info sheet without answering the question. She must have overheard his talk with old Hunter. He cast a glance at the color picture above the description. A sweet girl with almond-shaped eyes and cherry lips, smiling up at him like in a dream.
It's too noisy. We can hardly talk, old Hunter said. Let's move to the bench over there.
It would make a natural scene, Chen observed, the two of them discussing the information gathered at the matching corner. After all, the visit to the corner might have functioned like a prelude in a Sucho opera, which would then lead to what old Hunter had not yet disclosed. But Chen was uncomfortable at the idea of sitting there with those colorful umbrellas incessantly twirling in view. He looked up to see something like an antique bamboo tea pavilion at the end of the park trail. Let's have a cup of tea there, old Hunter. Years ago, I used to go to Bun Park for my English studies, but for a change, occasionally to this park too, sitting on a bench possibly just in that area. But I don't think there was a tea pavilion standing there at the time.
That's fine with me. Wherever you prefer, our nostalgic chief inspector. We can go to the hot water house next time.
For the time of the day, the business at the tea pavilion appeared practically non-existent. It was too expensive for the old and too old-fashioned for the young. Nor was it a traditional tea house. In addition to tea, it also sold soft drinks, coffee, and a variety of snacks. They turned out to be the only customers, sitting at a bamboo table outside, yet close enough to the pavilion window where they were able to have hot water added easily. The tea waiter brought out a teapot along with several small dishes of sugar-covered yangberries, roasted peanuts, and fried sunflower seeds, and placed all of them on the table before withdrawing into the pavilion without further ado.
The tea is not too bad, old Hunter said wistfully, taking a sip from the dainty cup. Alas, if only I could come here every morning with my birds, sipping at the tea, humming a Sucho opera tune. Carefree, just like other retirees.
Yes, after three sips at the tea, Chen said with a knowing smile, mimicking the old man's way of talking.
It's time to come down to business, just like in one of your favorite old proverbs. But retirees or not, who can afford to be really carefree in today's society?
Exactly. Like in another old proverb, people don't go to the temple without having to pray for some special favor from the Buddha image. And I have to talk to you, Chief, about a proposal made by my boss, Zhang Zhang.
Sure, it's something to talk about over the tea.
I was told about your taking sick leave from that new office of yours. It was a young secretary named Jin who picked up my phone call, but she hemmed and hawed about what's wrong with you. You're fine, aren't you?
Well, it's up to the people above to tell the doctor to say whether I'm fine or not. But it's an enjoyable break for me, I have to admit that.
But you're not a man who would enjoy such a leave, that much I know.
Old Hunter was spitting out a much-chewed tea leaf.
So how about joining our agency? As a special consultant, as Zhang Zhang has just discussed with me this morning, you may keep the position at that new office of yours, whether still on convalescent leave or not.
Chen was taken aback by the retired cop's suggestion, but he saw where it was coming from. One of the questions he had to answer for himself, however, was how long such a leave would last, and for that matter, how much worse his trouble could turn out to be. Besides, it could give his enemies another handle in the event of his being caught moonlighting for the agency. Not to mention the fact that private investigation was not officially allowed in the socialism with China's characteristics, with it practicable only in a sort of gray area.
Remember the consultant job you gave me at the traffic control office years ago, Chief? I mentioned it to Zhang Zhang,
and he thought it's a good idea for you to serve as an honorary consultant for our agency, with a six-figure pay annually. For a man of your caliber and connections, it's nothing. But you don't have to come to our agency regularly, no more than 4 or 5 times a year. And we'll talk, just like today, drinking tea in a park or listening to Sucho opera at a tea house. What a generous offer. Your agency must have been expanding and making a huge profit.
We started by catching those cheating husbands and making not so much, you know that. But then we had some more lucrative cases, doing what some of our big buck clients do not want police to do. Of course, we make risk control management our top priority, and you don't have to worry about it.
But I cannot get paid for doing nothing, simply drinking tea or enjoying Sucho opera in the name of a special consultant. You have to tell me what I am supposed to do.
Well, as a matter of fact, there's something you may be able to help us with at this moment. Not as an active investigator, of course, but believe it or not, your name has been brought up by our client, a mysterious man named Sima. In fact, he could have come to us with you in mind.
That's strange.
It's a long story, Old Hunter said, clearing his throat. To begin with, as an experienced gourmet, you must have heard about those most expensive dining places in the city.
I know a thing or two about those expensive restaurants, but I don't know exactly what you're talking about.
The most expensive one in the city today is not a restaurant. Rather, it's something called a private kitchen.
That's more and more interesting. Go on and tell me about it.
Chen was not unfamiliar with the trend of the so-called private kitchen dining, but he was amused at the ironic reversal of roles between the two men. Old Hunter was anything but a gourmet, and it was fun to have him deliver a culinary lecture in a Sucho opera fashion.
You know what? The real art of cooking is the last thing people care about in the restaurant business today. First and foremost for them, the profit. For instance, the chickens marked as free-range, natural food fed could be just a joke of imagination. Likewise, the shrimp not fresh, the fish long dead, the meat frozen for months, the vegetables rotten. You can go on and on. So imagine the quality there. But for a private family dinner, the host doesn't have a fixed menu, nor an expense spreadsheet to calculate for profit. That's why the private kitchen came into fashion for the wealthy.
Yes, I've heard something about private kitchens or private recipes, but they're like other restaurants in the end. They still have to open for business 7 days a week, so there's nothing that private except for the self-claimed private recipes.
But this one is truly different. It's in a private shikumen house, residential, not for business, with dinner served only for selective guests. Once a week, at a traditional round table for no more than 8 people, and the menu depending on the food supply of the day. People have to make a reservation long beforehand. What's more, they have to prove their qualifications.
What qualifications?
Wealth, social status, and so on. The minimum expense per person is at least 10,000 yuan, sometimes much more. The chef, as well as the host there, is a young woman named Min Li Hua, a courtesan, or a Mingyuan, a recently rediscovered word for a celebrated courtesan in the high society before 1949, since our official newspaper today will not admit the existence of courtesans in the socialism with China's characteristics.
Old Hunter resumed, stroking his chin energetically after taking another gulp of tea.
Not too long ago, I went to an Ernai, second concubine, cafe, for one of your investigations, you remember? Min is different. She is not kept by a man. Still single, but with a number of rich and powerful men dancing around her. They spend money like water in her company. At first, she just entertained those really close to her. But the word about a private kitchen dinner spread around, making it increasingly difficult to book, even at such an exorbitant price. And an invitation to the dinner meant people gained a lot of face, almost like an acknowledgement of their social status.
Chen nodded without making an immediate response,
thinking he had heard about the new trend. But of late, his own trouble left him with little mood for such a private kitchen dinner, let alone one of dubious reputation.
According to our client, Sima, Min is not just a consummate chef, but a knockout with incredibly charming grace and sophistication. She was from a good family in the Republican period before 1949. With her great-grandfather being a scholar-slash-official and a culinary connoisseur, and her grandfather being a wealthy banker, both of them spared no cost to develop the Min specials at the dinner table. She is said to have inherited the family recipes. That's how she got the internet nickname, Republican Lady.
The nickname does not sound politically correct, Chen said reflectively. Ours is People's Republic of China, under the Communist Party after 1949, not Republic of China, under the Nationalist or Kuomintang. The Republican seems to refer to the pre-1949 period exclusively.
As Sima has told us, the nickname was given to Min online because of someone named Lin Wei-yin, a beautiful, talented poetess who shone in the Republican period. No one like her has emerged since the Communist Party took power.
Lin Wei-yin. Yes, she's a gifted poetess who hosted a renowned literature salon with an elite circle of men competing for her attention. But she did not cook, or at least, she wasn't known for her culinary skill.
Chen decided to change the subject before digressing too far.
But what about Min's trouble?
She's in custody for a murder case after a private dinner party last Friday.
A murder case?
As private investigators, we make a point of keeping away from a case already under official investigation. As you know, some of those cases could have conclusions reached for political reasons, even before the beginning of the investigations. We know better than to get ourselves into trouble. But Sima turned out to be the one with numerous connections, as he assured us, and the retaining fee he offered was too high for our agency to say a downright no to.
How much?
$200,000 to start with, and another $200,000 at the end of the job, plus all expenses covered.
Unbelievable. But what does Sima want you to do for such an amount?
To prove she is innocent, and get her out as quick as possible.
Old Hunter paused theatrically again.
But there are some odd things about the case. Min is celebrated, but she's not involved in politics. And for that matter, she's not even a party member. But she's shuangued like a corrupt party official in an undisclosed location.
Literally, shuangue meant detention at a specific location and for a specific duration. It was not part of officially established legal procedure, but was supposedly justified in that, for some high-ranking party officials, once out of custody after the detention time limit, they could destroy evidence and conspire with their accomplices. In reality, shuangue was adopted mainly for damage control, through which the authorities made sure that any dirty details of corruption scandals would not come out. By the end of shuangue, it would be a matter of course for those involved to plead guilty to a pre-written script, leaving the party's great glorious image untarnished.
That's weird, Chen said, tapping first one finger, then two on the table.
What else have you learned about the case, in addition to the information from your client?
With Min locked up in an unknown location, there's no way for us to contact her. I've talked to you, but he has hardly heard anything about it in the Bureau. The case did not come under the Special Case Squad, but under Detective Xiong of the Homicide Squad, and then Internal Security took over.
Internal Security took over a murder investigation?
Astonishing, isn't it? I don't know any details yet. There's one possibility Sima discussed with us. Her trouble may come, partially at least, from her nickname of Republican Lady. Her popularity on social media spooked some orthodox party officials, who saw it as an endorsement of the Republican area values at the expense of the value system today.
Hold on, old Hunter. How old is she?
In her early 30s, but she grew up listening to those family stories of hers, about dinners and parties and cultivations and decorum in the Republican period.
In that very Shikumen house?
Her family was driven out of it during the Cultural Revolution. But several years ago, she managed to get the house back, and she made herself known with the online posts and blogs and pictures about the gracefulness of the Republican era. In short, her punishment could be seen as a public denouncement of the Republican myth. Politically,
I see, but even so, Shuangwei.
Chen cut himself short again. Several elderly people were walking over, dragging their feet toward the tea pavilion, carrying folded umbrellas in their hands and worn-out smiles on their faces. Having done their daily work at the matching corner, they were casting curious glances in the direction of the two men. Chen and old Hunter kept on drinking their tea, cracking the sunflower seeds, which broke the silence.
Now go on with the murder case itself,
Chen said, after the elderly people moved out of sight.
We're getting there, Chief. Her dinner parties, originally a means to entertain her guests, then became something like an end in themselves. A profitable business, it brought her extra income and extra connections, too. No way she could have afforded not to continue, but she had found it hard to manage all the preparation and cooking by herself. For a dinner at the Shikuman house, with no less than 12 courses, most of which had to be served fresh and hot, the chef hostess really had a hectic time, stir-frying the first special in the kitchen, rushing out to serve it at the table, saying a few polite words to the guests, explaining the beauty of the delicacy, before hurrying back into the kitchen for the next course. For an ordinary family dinner, that would probably be no big deal. A self-centered husband might go so far as to take pride with his wife's toiling and moiling around like that. But not so with Min. She's the one and only hostess, and the chef too. Besides, some of the guests at her table came not just for the culinary delights. An outline article about her dinner was titled, "She is so delicious, she could be devoured." It's a paraphrased quote from Confucius, and it's understandable that the men were not too pleased with her being constantly away from the table. So she hired people for help. One of them was named Qing, a clever, fast-learning apprentice who was soon able to cook in a fashion like hers. It gave Min a much-needed break. She did not have to run to the kitchen and back so many times during a meal. Unexpectedly, trouble came.
That sounds like an exciting Sucho opera, old Hunter. So it's finally coming to a climax?
Yes. After such a dinner party about a week ago, the Friday of the week before last, having had a cup too much, Min retreated to her bedroom earlier than usual, so the guests had to leave. Qing stayed on to take care of things in the kitchen. The next morning, Qing was found killed in the kitchen, the back of her head fractured with a heavy object. Min claimed that she had slept like a log throughout the night. As the one and only possible suspect, with no sign of forced entry to the Shikuman house, and with a plausible motive, as Min was said to be very upset with Qing for quitting for another job, she was put into custody.
Just because of a maid quitting?
It's unbelievable. And that's why Sima wants us to check into it. He does not believe she would have committed the crime because of it.
So your rich and romantic client offered you almost ½ million yuan for the job.
The autopsy has excluded the possibility of Qing having stumbled and hit her head on something. It could not have been an accident.
Has Sima offered you any different scenario about the case? Something he happened to have known?
No, he has not. In fact, I don't think Sima is his real name either. But we have promised to keep his background info confidential. Except that he is one with connections high up. As for her background info, I've gathered something for you in a folder.
What would happen to her? Chen said, without taking the folder. Without your looking into the case.
When she's out of Shuangwei, there'll be an open trial with a judge. Judge Liu Xiaohua, already assigned to the case. Most likely with a foregone verdict. You just need to think about her celebrity status as a Republican lady in today's politics. That's one thing Sima said to us. And there are wild stories and speculations about the case on the internet. Some are describing the murder case as a setup. Some are digging into her relations with the wealthy and powerful. Some are even pointing their fingers at the assignment of the judge,
who is said to have been on the waiting list of her dinner parties for a long time, yet without success, and who would consequently revenge himself.
Did your client give any specific instructions for the job?
Chen had to cut the Suzhou opera singer short again. Some details he could check online himself.
With no alibi for her, and with her locked up in an unknown location, there's little we could possibly do for her.
Old Hunter paused again, draining the tea.
It was then that Sima mentioned you as the trump card.
How?
Sima said that you could help. Apparently, he has done his homework about you, saying that with Detective Yu as your longtime partner, it makes sense for you to talk over a cup of tea with me.
That was shrewd of Sima. With Chen on leave, it might not be a good idea to drag the ex-inspector into the investigation in the open, but it was a different story for him to have a cup of tea with old Hunter.
But what the convalescent leave means, you know only too well, old Hunter. I may be watched. Any misstep on my part could easily get you into trouble too. In your phone call.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.